May we begin this panel with a question for, of course, led by our Finance Secretary. And if we may ask Secretary Diokno, Tony, would you like to ask the first question?
Sure. We received this question from our partner banks. And Secretary Diokno, if you could please explain how the government's medium-term fiscal framework, how this will guide the country's fiscal consolidation and achieve the target of reducing the deficit to GDP to 3% by 2028.
Well, as mentioned earlier, before the pandemic, our debt to GDP ratio was, if I remember right, less than 40%. That's pretty good by world standards, okay? But because of the pandemic, we have to spend money for the vaccines, we have to increase expenditures on healthcare, etc. So right now it's slightly above 60%. Still pretty good by international standards, but we are committed to consolidate so that we the first order of business when President Marcos Jr. assume office is to prepare that medium-term fiscal framework. That's the first ever in the Philippines. So for the next 6 years, we have a plan so that we will reduce the deficit to GDP ratio to 3%, back to 3% by 2028. We want to go back to the threshold of 60% by 2025. And so, of course, we will maintain our expenditures for infrastructure at 5 to 6%. That's very important. So we are doing everything to consolidate. And in fact, that's the prescription. While you can prepare come up with a big buffer so that we don't know when the next crisis will come. So that's the purpose of the consolidation. Okay, thank you.
And as the World Bank just noted, we may achieve upper middle income status within the next 2 years. So yay. And so our next question is for our central bank governor. This is a question that was sent in earlier by one of the banks. CPI inflation eased slightly to 8.6% year on year in February 2023. Has inflation peaked? Is it now starting to decline? You actually already noted it in your presentation earlier. What's the expectation for inflation in 2023 and what are the key risks to this forecast?
Okay, the inflation actually has already fallen to the lower end of the BSP forecast from the month, which is 7.6%. But even more telling is what's happening to the change in the prices from 1 month to the next. To keep it very simple, the price index in March is actually slightly lower than the price index in January. Of course, January is a busier month than March. So if you adjust for seasonality, practically there's zero inflation between January and March. Of course, that's hard to maintain because the reason you have very low inflation is some of the food items that were too expensive, like the famous sibuyas.
Onions.
they look like jewelry. They're so expensive, you know. Going down. So our own forecast is inflation on average per every month will be below, will be 0.3% or lower, which if you calculate, we will have below 4% inflation by November or December this year. And therefore, the average inflation in 2024 will be slightly below 3%. Now, what is the key risk? Well, our lesson is in the past, we imported inflation. Fortunately, and in the past, the problem was low prices. So we actually missed the target at the low side, right? I think 2015 and 2016, 0.7% and 1.3% inflation relative to the low end of a target of 2%. So clearly what happens to the rest of the world will affect us. And unfortunately, the global picture now has shifted from deflation to inflation. Now, the other threat to it, of course, is the weather. But we have already learned that we should be more agile in fact, Secretary Balisakan is already doing this, more agile to forecast what the effect of typhoons, droughts, and therefore the import permits will be there when there are domestic shortages. So we're quite confident, unless there are really things that happen that's currently not in the horizon, that we will have 3%, we will be well within our 2-4% inflation target starting November this year.
That's good news. Good news. Would you like to ask the next question, Tony?
Sure. This one's for Secretary Pangandaman. The question is essentially what are the priority sectors in the recently passed 2023 national budget, and how do they support the Philippine Development Plan?
I think it was already explained a while ago. But maybe what's important is, again, consistent with the medium-term fiscal framework, our 8-point socioeconomic agenda is the fiscal consolidation. Given that our expenditures will be a little over just 20% of GDP from now until 2020, that will help us bring down our fiscal deficit and also our debt. So among the priority areas, of course, again, to support our, because the governor here mentioned the onions, we give a lot of big boost in our agriculture and agrarian reform sector. That is about 29% increase. It's actually the first time that we're giving enough funding for to support our agriculture sector, just to have enough food in our tables. And of course, we'll also, again, as part of our social program, we will increase our health sector provisions. That's a boost of about 15% of the national budget compared to last year. And social programs as well. It will reach up to 650 billion for this year. And that's a 10% increase in terms of cash assistance to our society for a productive and so ensure that no one is left behind. And of course, apart from the education, which is we will give a high priority as mandated by the Constitution, apart from the basic and tertiary education investment, we will also continually support our trainings and seminar and workshops for our VocTech. This is to ensure that we'll have a productive workforce.
It's interesting that an emerging theme is agriculture. Governor Medalla started us off on the onions, and then Secretary Pangandaman mentioned that there will be a priority on investing in agricultural productivity and competitiveness. So, Secretary Balisakan, could you please discuss initiatives on the development of the Philippine agriculture sector, including legislative priorities expected to support these industries?
The basic challenge in agriculture is the low productivity. Productivity growth, production growth, in fact, is much lower than population growth. So obviously, you have to import. But given the instability also of food markets, we need to enhance the capacity of the domestic economy to produce for local consumption. And this is where productivity is so important, because the Philippines, despite being it's still a largely agricultural economy. And if you look at it from the population side, labor force side, And increasing productivity is the only way to go. And there, we know that the root causes or the roots of the low productivity is basically the neglect over many years, decades, in fact, of the sector by way of infrastructure development, the misinformed or ill-informed policies in the sector, including the longest land reform program that we have had, that had caused so much rural stagnation to the extent that land reform program, unfinished land reform program, made rural markets, particularly land markets, very distorted, no? And therefore lending to agriculture has lagged far behind than what one would expect. So here, the Marcos administration is addressing those the roots of those problems, trying to now to address this land reform issues, trying to solve this supply chain issues, the infrastructure lags, particularly connecting the rural farms, the farms to the markets by way of massive farm to market roads initiatives, and so on and so forth. With that, of course, the other problem there is, as I noted earlier, the production growth is lagging behind the income growth and population growth, and that means that we would have to increase our capacity to also to import and import timely and adequately, and that is where the Marcos administration came in lately to ensure forming a committee that is quite independent from vested agencies, you know, to determine the level and timing of importation if so required. And I think that's a very important development.
So thank you, Secretary. And you mentioned infrastructure, how the Marcos Jr. administration is prioritizing infrastructure. And part of this infrastructure is also digital infrastructure. And we're lucky to have with us this morning our ICT Secretary, Ivan Uy. Secretary, may we ask you about digital infrastructure this time? Could you tell us about the digital transformation program of the Philippine government? Is the government actively seeking partnerships in its digitalization efforts to pursue its public financial management reform agenda and as well as other programs?
Thank you very much. Well, actually, the digital public infrastructure is one of the key components of the Marcos administration. And because it has been identified as a major factor in GDP growth, especially in its ability to provide digital inclusion and financial inclusion in many of the rest of the population that has never been on board in the economic contribution that they provide to the country. So, we are aggressively pursuing this digital connectivity. Much has been said on how digital connectivity and internet access contributes to the GDP of the country. And we are fully cognizant of the challenges that we have being an archipelago with more than 7,000 islands. There has been some market failure in terms of being the telcos being able to provide digital connectivity in many of the geographically isolated and disadvantaged sector, mainly because it does not really make economic sense for them, given the population, the purchasing power of those remote communities in the islands and in the hinterlands up in the mountains. So government has to come in to provide that connectivity. And considering also a large segment of that population being in the unbanked sector, the numbers range from 50-40% of the Philippine population who are unbanked. And these are mostly in those areas. So once we provide the connectivity in those areas, then provide them with all the different resources, whether e-commerce platforms, digital banking, digital payments, access to online credit facilities, whether for their agricultural loans, disaster mitigation assistance, and being able to participate now and join in the economic marketplace in the country. I think this is one area where that digital connectivity impact on the economy has not been fully factored in to the computation on our GDP growth. We need to perhaps seek assistance from our partners to determine how the impact will be in terms of the economic contribution of the unbanked, previously unbanked, to now being part of the digital economy of the country, and how far that will provide the contribution to our economic development. So we do welcome more investments in this area. We have, as mentioned by my colleagues in the cabinet, several laws have been passed to liberalize foreign direct investments. And the response has been very positive. Many telecom companies, well, the most foremost of which is Starlink. It's one of the first adopters or first companies that took the initiative in availing of those liberalization and investing in the Philippines and using the Philippines actually as its first location in Asia. So the Philippines will be the first Starlink location in Asia that will be using that satellite technology on low Earth orbit, which is very appropriate considering all the different islands that we have in the sector.
Thank you very much, Secretary Uy. And as you were talking about digital connectivity and the Philippines being an archipelago, it just brought to mind how tropical the climate is in the Philippines and how people seem to be feeling very cold in this room at the moment. So if we could ask for the air conditioning to be adjusted for the comfort of our friends and colleagues here in this room. The favorable attributes of the Philippines, in addition to its tropical climate, we'd like to bring a private sector voice into this conversation. We've heard from the international development organizations as well and our officials. So Mr. Mike Rodriguez, Managing Director of Macquarie Asset Management, what are the favorable attributes of the Philippines as an investment destination? What makes the Philippines stand out?
Well, good morning, everyone. I guess it's in the interest of time and your attention, I won't go through all the attributes that have already been covered by our honorable secretaries at length. In particular, Secretary Balisakan's page on the different items that the investors would like to see in the Philippines are now available to be exploited by the private sector coming into the Philippines as investors. There is one point, however, that I'd like to share, and it's on behalf of most of our colleagues in the financial sector, and that is the very refreshing change of events following this entry of this administration. I'm speaking of the time when our secretaries reached out to the investing communities and asked about what are the things you would like to see us do to help push the government's agenda on it, particularly on infrastructure investment. That was a refreshing change. Well, we have never had that approach from government before, and we thank you for that. But it didn't end with just that particular interaction. it led to action on their part. Like, for example, the implementing rules and regulations were immediately changed. And all other reforms are now being introduced to make sure that the country is more attractive as an investment destination. As you may appreciate, most of the larger investors look at the region as a whole. And the Philippines has always been a very interesting bright spot. And now I think with all the reforms being introduced, we will see more interest. And particularly with the change of foreign ownership laws, greater activity in accordance with the government's objectives. So that's all I wanted to say. You have all the facts before you, and I think it's time for us to seriously consider the Philippines for more investment.
Thank you for the strong vote of confidence, Mike. We're now opening up the floor.
Now for the fun questions. Part.
So there is a microphone that will be roaming the room to anyone who raises her or his hand. Any question from the floor?
The gentleman to the right.
Please. The microphone's coming to you, sir.
If we may also request those who will be asking questions to please introduce themselves for the benefit of the audience.
Thank you so much. My name is Nelson Garcia, and I'm the president of the Washington Intergovernmental Professional Group. In the previous gathering, I believe about 2 years ago, the issue of the infrastructure investment in the airport, Manila International, was discussed heavily. I didn't quite see it in today's gathering, but can you give us an update on where the status is of the airport as it relates to building a new airport or enhancing the one in Angeles City? And from a personal point of view, one of the frustrating parts of NAIA is the fact that you cannot connect from one terminal to the other without having to go outside and going around. And it's kind of dissuades, I think, a little bit of the business opportunity for the Philippines when the first experience you have of a country at the airport is not conducive to business opportunities. So I just wanted to see where that is right now in terms of the investment.
Yeah. Well, on the Manila International Airport, there are three airports there. One, airport one, two, three.
Terminal.
The second one is Philippine Airlines, right? Now that will be converted into a purely domestic terminal. So the terminal two, the terminals one and two will now be used for international travel. There is a newly constructed airport, the Clark International Airport. That's superior quality, okay? And so I think the most recent development is that we plan to privatize the management of these airports, okay? So, for example, there's a new international airport in Legazpi, and then one in Lagindingan, one in Iloilo, and we will try to privatize as much as possible the running of the airport. And of course, I read somewhere that there are some 18 major airport upgrading projects that will be completed before the end of the year, according to the Department of Transportation and DOTR Secretary. Is that correct?
Yeah. Mm. Let me add that in the case of the NAIA, the main gateway, international gateway, our plan is, and there's now an advanced discussion on this involving the private sector, is to use PPP for the maintenance and operations of that airport. There are already some expressions of interest by private groups, by the private sector. There are also, of course, ongoing developments, international airports, one in Bulacan, and there are another one also in Sangli. And of course, there is the Clark, which is also being rapidly transformed to accommodate the expansion of airlines services. So that there's that, I think that we should see improvements in the major gateway, the Naya, pretty soon. As soon as our plan is to get this on board, the approval of the proposal for PPP and the maintenance and operations of Naya, hopefully before the end of the year. We're just waiting for the submission of the project proponents for the proposal.
So we can look forward to better airports in the Philippines. Next question.
The lady. Yes, okay. And then the lady at the edge of the.
Hello, my name is Evan Louie. I'm the founding principal of Asian Pacific Joint Ventures. What we do is create joint ventures and consortiums to pursue infrastructure in the Philippines. And I just want to kind of get a sense of what you feel is to encourage US-based contractors to pursue infrastructure opportunities as foreign contractors. Today, we have a couple of our GCs here from Bechtel, HDR, Sorensen Gross, and JED as well. So yeah, heading the audience, yeah. I'd like to get some feedback on how you promote that. We're also handling Asian Development Bank's roadshow here in the United States for infrastructure, disaster mitigation, clean tech, smart cities, and renewables. So love to hear your feedback on that. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. The secretaries on stage have indicated that we share the microphone with Undersecretary from the Department of Trade and Industry. Yeah.
So this is a surprise, but nevertheless, let me share with you that, for example, the target of the I'm from the Board of Investments, and this year, just for context, in 2021, we've registered about 650 billion. Pesos worth of projects. 2023 registered 712 billion pesos worth of project. For this year, we initially targeted, the president asked us to increase our target to 1 trillion pesos. But for the first 3 months of this year, that's why we increased our target for that 1.5 trillion pesos. So it's double the 2022 target. And most of these are in the infrastructure, in particular renewable energy. You could really see that this administration walks the talk. So you can really see that Secretary Benjoka mentioned that we have liberalized the ownership, foreign ownership of renewable energy projects, including in particular solar, wind, and tidal. There's been an influx of interest and after registrations in this area. And then second getting investment registrations is in telecoms in particular. For the first 2 years, the 2021 and 2022 were mostly in terms of the third-party telco towers. But right now we are already seeing more of the broadband services, including what the secretary we mentioned earlier, the Philippines will be the second in Asia to have the low Earth orbit satellite from Starlink. In fact, in 2 weeks' time, Starlink and our Philippine Space Agency will be doing a demonstration project in one of the farthest barrios in the Philippines. Now, to answer your question, in addition to all the things that you mentioned, may I also say that the president also issued executive order number 18 or a green lane project for all of these very important strategic projects, including on infrastructure, that assures you a very smooth permitting process. So in short, in addition to all of the policy openings, liberalization, there is also a very big component on ease of doing business. And you can be sure that the Board of Investments and all of our other investment promo agencies will be hand-holding you all throughout. Thank you.
Yeah. Undersecretary Perry Rudolfo from the Department of Trade and Industry, please have a chat with him after this event. Yeah. One last question. That's all we have time for. The lady at the edge of the fourth row, I believe. Yeah, the microphone's coming to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for today's thoughtful presentation. My name is Carol Fowler. I'm with Marriott International. We currently have 6 hotels in country and a development pipeline of 17 other hotels in the works. And it's not a hard sell. It's a beautiful country. So many folks, especially after COVID, are itching to get to the Philippines and just some warmer weather as well. My question is related on a more macro level to the airport question that had been asked previously. with the ambitious infrastructure goals, how do you see infrastructure, both physical as well as digital, tying into increasing capacity for travel and tourism?
Okay. Who wants to answer that?
RC.
Part of the infrastructure development program is to open up more direct flights to particularly in tourist areas like Boracay or Palawan, so that tourists don't have to go to Manila first before they go to their final destination, and that means improving the air infrastructure there, not only the airports but the connectivity, particularly the roads, the shipping lines, etc., leading to the final destinations. As I showed earlier, the bulk of that infrastructure development is in that connectivity. And from a development perspective, what we are really aiming to achieve is to ensure that the development is inclusive, meaning the lagging regions would now have the opportunity to catch up with the rapidly growing areas of the country.
Okay. Yes.
I just want to add on the digital connectivity side. Well, we all know that in the 21st century, digital connectivity is the new road, the new railroad in the 21st century. And we're actively working with the Department of Tourism in providing broadband infrastructure in all the 94 identified tourist sites in the country. At the same time, we are working also with the local governments in providing them with the necessary support in developing the surrounding communities and those tourist sites in allowing providing them with free Wi-Fi programs in order to also empower the local community in supporting those tourist areas. Additionally, we have two major programs that we are deploying. One is our digital nomad program, which will allow more people to work not from home, but from the beach. From the beautiful areas. And that leads me to the second program that we have, which is the Geeks on the Beach program.
<That's me. laughs>
So those are the two programs that we are pushing by providing better connectivity. People can vacation in those areas, but they can also do work in many of those different islands all around the country, beautiful islands all around. Thank you.
So on that note, we expect all of us geeks to be on the beach in the Philippine Islands soon.
Whether for R&R or for work, basically.
Whether for R&R or for work. And unfortunately, that's all the time that we have today. Let's give our panelists a warm round of applause.